always been so kind, but now they brought you away from me. I hope they didn't get your mind. Your heart is too strong anyway. We need to fetch back the time they have stolen from us.
Of the presentation. During the last 10 seconds, I will indicate my finger the number of seconds. If you have not finished your presentation after 20 minutes, you will be stopped in order to proceed with the Q&A period. The Q&A period of maximum of 5 minutes is allocated as allocated to the jury and at the end of the presentation. Please note that at any time you cannot say or reference the name or the location of your university. I will now let the judge introduce himself. You can start the presentation with Dr. Jérôme
Lacroix, Open Investors.
Caroline
Lavoie,
fiscaliste.
François Azur, fiscaliste.
My name is Jean-Vianney Cordero, and one of my goals is to travel the world.
My name is Linda Zhang, and one of my goals is to start a charity to help children in need.
My name is Ariel Deborah, and one of my goals is to learn how to surf.
Now, we all have goals and dreams. Whether they seem small or big, each and every one of them is important. And that is why we are here, Ritokman family, to help each and every one of you achieve your dreams and goals. Now, before we get into any detail, I'll just give you an idea of what to expect in this presentation. First off, we'll discuss Denny's situation and the situation with Boomer. Then we'll discuss Yvonne and the situation of the rental property and the transfer of property to both his wife and his son. Next, we'll move on to Jacques and his automotive company and whether or not he's actually going to go ahead and incorporate this. Then we'll discuss Marc-Antoine and his situation with the new company that he's taking a contract with. And lastly, we'll just wrap up and discuss the key takeaways from this presentation. And so now I'm going to pass you along to Ari and Linda, who are going to discuss Denny and Beaumur.
Denny, we're going to start off by discussing Beaumur because this is a company you've started. It's a company that's been part of your family for the last 39 years. We understand your concerns about the future of your company, and what we're here today to do is address simple and effective tax solutions and opportunities that can help you move forward with your company. The three solutions I'll be discussing is optimizing your corporate structure, either by doing a Section 68 estate freeze or by setting up a holding company and a trust. Another solution that I will look into is the sale of shares and the implications that carry forward with that. Let me start off by discussing what an estate freeze is, and I want to make this as simple as possible for you. When you started your company, you put in $1,000 in common shares. The fair market value of those common shares today are $2 million. What an estate freeze allows you to do is to freeze the value of your common shares by converting them to preferred shares. What are preferred shares? Preferred shares are shares in a company that will still allow you voting rights if you deem so, and there are shares in a company that will pay you out an annual fixed remunerated amount. How this estate freeze will work is that your common shares of $2 million will become preferred shares of $2 million. Therefore, the common shares in your company will have an ACB of $0. You can then give all of these ACB shares of $0 to your children and allow them to benefit from the future of your company. The pros of this thing is that you can make your preferred shares voting, therefore you will retain voting rights in your company and you will retain full control of the company. You will get a fixed remunerated amount, and also this will be done at a tax-free transfer. Therefore, it's very beneficial to you because you can do it today. One of the best options about the estate freeze is that you've indicated to us that the value of your company is going to go up. It's going to continue to increase in value as it's done over the last 39 years. Therefore, you should freeze the company right now in order for your kids to benefit from the future growth of the company. I'd like to address another equally beneficial tax option. Now, this might look confusing to you. I'd like to explain to you the current corporate structure of your company. You are the sole shareholder. You own 100% of your company, and you own Beaumeuble, your operating company. All right? I suggest that you should create a holding company and the Rituel discretionary family trust. Let me walk you through all the mechanics of how this will happen. Now, if you created your holding company, Beaumeuble will be able to pay dividends to the holding company, and dividends between companies are allowed to transfer at a tax-free basis. Furthermore, the holding company can hold these dividends, and they can defer them. And this will be beneficial because they won't pay them out to the trust until you want them to. The trust is important because you stated that you and your children want to equally benefit from the future growth of the company. The benefits of having a discretionary trust is that you'll be able to make flexible distributions to your children. This means that if one of your kids decides to get married, as one is already, and start a family, you'll be able to flow more money from the trust to him. So this is a beneficial tax opportunity that we come up for you. So you've said that you're not 100% you're not 100% satisfied with the sale of shares, but we wanted to run you through what it would look like. So first, you have a lifetime capital gains exemption because your company is a CCPC. However, in order for you to crystallize that capital exemption, your company must qualify as a QSBC. So what do all these words and letters mean? Well, in the last 2 years, 50% of the fair market value of your assets have to be used in an active business. We've evaluated your financial statements and we found that this criteria is met, and it's very likely to be met over the next couple of years. However, there's another criteria that comes with the test, and that's at the date of sale, 90% of the fair market values need to be used in an active business. However, in your company, you have redundant assets. These are assets like the vacant land that you're holding that total up to $275 and put this QSBC criteria in jeopardy. Therefore, before the sale of your company, and we recommend if you were to do this, potential tax filing point, you should purify your company by selling these redundant assets. I want to talk to you about the personal implications of tax that are facing you. So the first one is, well, you have a shareholder loan from your company, and this shareholder loan has been outstanding for two balance sheet dates. Under the Income Tax Act, this will be deemed an inclusion by the CRA, and you're going to be taxed on it in the next current fiscal year. This is something you need to address immediately. And if you have the available resources, you should look into paying your current loan off. Another thing is, we've realized that you've been paying yourself in $97,000 of remuneration in dividends. If you want to optimize your RRSP contributions as you're looking forward to retirement in the next couple of years, you should consider paying yourself salaries. The reason why salaries will constitute as earned income, and they will let you increase your RRSP contribution limit. I would like to pass it off to Linda to discuss more tax points for Beaumeuble and Denis.
So before we get too carried away by future considerations for Beaumeuble, we first have to look at its current tax situation. So for the fiscal year ended November 30th, 2014, we've calculated a taxable income of about $400,000 for your company. And this is due to certain additions and deductions that you can carry out in order to carry this. So we're going to run you through some of the additions and deductions. Thank you. So these are some of the main additions that you need to add back to your net income from accounting. So you provided us with the financial statements at your year end, and these are some of the items that need to be added back, notably the accounting depreciation and amortization of $100,000. And this all adds up to almost $120,000 in which will be taxable to you. Next up, we will look at the deductions from your accounting net income. And these only constitute a terminal loss of almost $6,000. This is from the sale of the disposal of your machinery, your processing machinery that you sold at the beginning of this year. Next up, there's also the CCA that you can elect to take out in this year, and we would recommend that you take it out because it does reduce your taxable income for the year by about $120,000, and that's a significant amount for you. So this total is $125,000. And next up, we have the Division C deductions. So this is for the charitable contributions that you made throughout the year, which total $7,900. So all of this total together will give you a taxable income of about $400,000 for this year, for the 2014 fiscal year, which will be taxed at a corporate tax rate of 38%. And then, of course, you need to apply your federal abatement rate of 10% and other such rates, which will overall give you a tax payable. Next, we will pass it to Jean.
Perfect. Thank you, Linda. So we're done the first phase of our strategic tax planning. We've discussed Denis's situation and the situation of Beaumeuble. The next part is to discuss Yvan and the situation of four main items: the rental properties, the transfer of the rental property to the wife, the transfer of the rental property to your son, Jeff, and the rental property attribution of income. And we're just going to look at if that actually is going to occur. So in terms of what your current situation looks like, you have an annual income of $120,000. This is coming from salary directly from Beaumeuble. You also have rental income of $60,000. And we've also included an income attribution of interest income. This is money that you've given to your wife, and she's invested it. But this would actually be reattributed back to you. And the amount for 2013 comes to $2,370. So we've included that in the amount of your total earnings. Now, in terms of the property transfer, so according to the information that you've given us, you and your wife basically transferred the property on your own, and you never actually wrote anything to the government, you never filed anything. So we actually suggest that you go back and amend that return of 2013 and have a joint election filed for Section 73. What this allows you to do is allows you to transfer that property at the UCC, the underappreciated capital cost, and the ACB, the adjusted cost base, basically the tax values of these property of this property to your wife, so that there's no like tax implication of this transfer. And this needs to be done through amending the 2013 tax return. Now, if you look at Judson's 2013 total income, the new total income is just from the rental income of this property of $22,320. We've removed the amount of the attribution of the interest income because now it's no longer her income. It's attributed back to yourself, Yvonne. Now, what does the 2014 income look like? Well, some interesting things happened in 2014. Your wife, Judson, decided to sell the property, and so there are many different implications of this. If we look through them, first of all, there's rental income of $18,360. This is for the entire property until the date of sale. So we need to include this in her income. Then we have a capital gain on the sale of the land. So the sale of the land occurs for $47,000, and we use the adjusted cost base of $30,000, which was transferred through that Section 73 election. And that gives us a capital gain of $17,000 and a taxable capital gain of $8,500. Now, if we look at our capital gain for the building and the taxable capital gain for the building, it comes to a total taxable capital gain of $30,500. So these are not insignificant amounts. Now the next point is the recapture on the building. And so the next slide actually gives a good idea of the detail of where this number is coming from. Per the information you've given us, you've claimed the maximum amount of CCA in each of the years on this. And so therefore there will be a recapture because this asset was sold for more than the adjusted cost base. So yes, there will be a capital gain and there will also be recapture. So basically, this is just giving an idea of the different amounts that were the amounts of CCA claimed in the third to last column each year. But basically, this amount is going to be taken back by the government. And so, if we look on the bottom hand, right hand side of the screen, we can see that the ACB is $208,000, the UCC is $174,000, and so the difference is the recapture of about $34,000. Please note that the 2014 capital cost allowance is prorated for the October sale and not for the entire year. Now, other considerations. You mentioned that your son, Pierre, who's currently 17, is going to be turning 18. And what a wonderful birthday present for you to transfer that rental property over to him. So what are the implications of this? Well, according to the information that you've given to us and the rules of the Income Tax Act, we believe that the deemed proceeds of disposition will be at fair market value. So what are the implications of this? Well, there will likely be some kind of taxable capital gain and capital gain associated with this. And if you've taken capital cost allowance on this property, there would potentially be recapture. Now, there would be no attribution of rental income back to Yvonne because this transfer would happen. And again, it would be deemed disposition at fair market value, and they would be taxed on the gain, the recapture, and after that, the property belongs to your son, and there's no income attribution. He's over 18 years old, and so we don't need to worry about this. In terms of the cost, there were no figures given exactly in terms of the cost of the capital gain and the taxable capital gain, any recapture. But if we look at the similar property for Jacinthe, and when she sold the property, we can get a kind of an idea of how much this would be. And we have an estimate of about $25,000 to $50,000 in taxable capital gain, and recapture of potentially $25,000. So again, these are significant amounts, and they need to be discussed with you and your wife and your son before making any further moves. Jacinthe has also given us the information that she'd like to return to the workforce. She took the time off so that she could spend it with the children and help them really grow up together and be there for them. But now she has time, so she'd like to return to the workforce. So we think, why not let her go and work for Beaumarble? This would be an excellent opportunity for her to increase her income. And there will be many positive things that come from this, including one of which would be to maximize her RRSP contributions. And so this basically wraps it up for the section on Yvonne. The next section is going to be discussing Jacques and basically all the different things related to his automotive company and whether or not he needs to incorporate this.
Thank you, Jean. Jacques, let me explain to you why it's vitally important for you to incorporate your business. The difference between a sole proprietorship and an incorporation is that an incorporation is a separate legal entity. This means there will be limited liability, and that's important given that you're operating in the automotive industry. However, a more important benefit is that if you do incorporate your business, you'll be able to take advantage of a Section 85 tax-free rollover, which is going to let you roll over your assets into your business at a tax-free basis. Other benefits of incorporating your company is that if your company does qualify as a CCBC, you could take advantage of the small business deduction. Furthermore, if ever you plan on selling your company, you will also be able to crystallize your $800,000 capital gains exemption. Let me take you into more detail about the Section 85 rollover. So the mechanics, the step-by-step process of how this works is you're going to have to file an election with your company and then select the properties that you, the properties and items that you would like to roll over into your company. One of the items that we don't recommend you roll over is the accounts receivable balance. And this is because there's a Section 22 rollover that we will discuss in our report, which will be more beneficial. And this Section 85 rollover will let you roll over, so your rolling stock, your machinery equipment, your leasehold improvements, and your computer equipment at their ACBs, and they're going to be included into your corporation. Furthermore, we'd like to address your daughter, Amelie. She's 5 years old, she's getting ready to go to school, and what better way, to value her education than set up RESP, an education savings plan. And that's something we definitely encourage you to do because the government will match contributions to that plan.
So next, Mr. Marc-Antoine, we've heard that you've received some tax advice from your friends. And unfortunately, we'd like to give you a second opinion that might not quite go with what they've told you. So basically, what they've been recommending is that you set up a personal service corporation. Unfortunately, you do not qualify for this, and the benefits of this are not as they have said that they would be. So you would need to hire at least 5 employees for you to qualify as a PSC. In this case, you've already said that you don't think that hiring employees would be necessary for the operations that you were planning to carry out with your corporation. As well, there are not really any significant tax advantages because of the investment income that you've put into it and the investment income that you will be receiving from it. Because the CRA has put into place integration rules in order to stop any tax advantages from doing so. So the implications of setting up a PSC would be basically you would not be able to take advantage of RSP. Because you would be receiving dividends, as well as you would be taxed at the highest marginal rate of 29%, and you would have an additional tax due to integration rules. So overall, we do not recommend this option. What you could do would be to perhaps be considered a self-employed individual, in which case you could have several deductions that could be applied to your income. However, there are quite a few criteria that need to be respected, and we don't quite think you follow some of these criteria, but we can discuss further to help you further planify this aspect of your life.
And so in conclusion, we believe that with our strategic tax planning recommendations for you, Denis, and your entire family, this will allow the entire Hutomed family to enjoy much future growth and success. Thank you very much for your time, and at this point, we'd like to open the floor to a question and answer period.
Je peux vous poser ma question en français? Vous ne m'avez pas parlé concernant Jacques, qui a prêté 20 000 $ à son ami Martin. Est-ce qu'il y a quelque chose à faire avec ça ou c'est complètement perdu parce que Martin ne l'a pas remboursé? Il ne le remboursera jamais.
Est-ce que c'est correct si je réponds en anglais?
Oui.
Merci. Caroline, thank you for your question. Once you roll over your accounts receivable under Section 22 into your corporation, you'll be able to account for bad debts. And given that that Jacques has told us that the money from his friend is uncollectible, you'll be able to write this off and decrease your business income due to that uncollectible.
Okay.
No, she's talking about the 20 grand that Jack lent to a friend. Yeah, I lent like 20 grand to a friend and he lost it. What happened to it?
His friend who went bankrupt?
Yeah.
Well, so that receivable from his friend that he had lent that loan, because it's uncollectible, your business can write it off as it's a bad debt to the business.
Okay.
Is it possible to use the lifetime capital gains exemption with the estate freeze?
Yes, it is. The sale of preferred shares would qualify as if the company did qualify as a QSBC, mm-hmm. The sale of preferred shares would go to the capital gains exemption.
Okay, and you do recommend to sell the land for qualifying the business as a QSBC, right?
The vacant land, we do recommend if you are going to purify your company, that would be one of the steps.
Okay, so it doesn't qualify right now, right? Or does it qualify?
Currently, it was very close to the threshold.
Okay. Okay, and what are the advantages and disadvantages of creating a trust?
So one of the advantages are, under a discretionary trust, it would be controlled by a beneficiary. So in the event that you were to pass away, a designated beneficiary could control the trust and the outflows to your children. And this could be beneficial because all the children could benefit from the money. One of the disadvantages is you have a big family. Your family is going to last forever. And any assets or any property in a trust after 21 years is deemed to be disposed and reacquired, so that could create tax disadvantages.
Ouais, dans la fois, vous avez présenté la conciliation de revenus comptables et fiscales au début. La fois, ma question, c'est par rapport au congrès, est-ce que vous avez déduit le plein montant?
Le congrès, non.
Les frais de congrès de 3 000 $ pour le congrès à Toronto?
Non, c'est ça justement, parce que c'est. For meals and expenses, only 50% is deductible. So we could only deduct the portion that we had to add back, because it was already expensed, so we had to add back the portion that was non-deductible.
Okay, mais comme sur la facture, c'est juste marqué facture pour frais de congrès 3 000 $. Qu'est-ce qu'on fait avec les repas?
Ouais, on a dû prendre une portion de. Ouais. En fait, il aurait fallu prendre la portion que. We should have taken the portion that was only composed of meals. In this case, there's like a reasonable allowance for each day per meal, which would be maybe like $51, I think, per day.
Yeah. With the holding company involved, will I be able to qualify Bulmer shares as a QSBC with the holding company in place for future freeze?
For future freeze? That's a very good question. We have to get back to you on the specifics, but we'd like to reiterate that one of the most beneficial parts of the holding company is that it's going to give you the option to defer your dividends.
Okay, but which shares I would qualify for QSBC with the holding company in place?
With the holding company, yeah. The common shares.
Common shares of Bulmer?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.